New Line has the right sensibilities to have been able to resurrect this franchise the right way.
It was really the perfect home for Jason and Friday the 13th. Sean Cunningham was back as the producer and he wanted to do something different.
Ever since the pre-production of Friday the 13th Part 7, Paramount Pictures tackled the idea to combine two of the largest heavyweights of the slasher genre for a blood-soaked slash-a-thon. But even prior to the talks, fans fantasized about the concept since, after all, twice as many killers must mean twice as much blood. For many years, the thought would remain a fantasy as children defended their favorite icon in schoolyards across the country. But finally, after 15 years of the initial talks, the icons found themselves side by side on the same screen, but not without making it there in shame. Friday the 13th Part 8 was Paramount's final attempt to keep the franchise alive. They heightened the budget and explored possible gimmicks to nourish and increase a bloodthirsty audience. Of course, an old idea returned to the table as director Rob Heaton suggested they introduce New Line Cinema's Freddy Krueger into the 8th installment.
So, believe it or not, I had a thought of combining Freddy and Jason in a movie. And I'm not sure whether I was the first one who came up with that idea or not, probably not, because it seems like such an obvious idea. But they explored it. And what they found out was, between the two studios and attorneys and all these other things, they couldn't come to an arrangement that would make everybody happy to combine them into one movie. So that went by the wayside.
Since no agreements were reached, no battle would ensue. Although fans would be disappointed with the final concept of the 8th film, they had no choice but to accept it. With the conclusion of Jason Takes Manhattan and a poor box office earning, it looked like the only thing being slashed was the franchise itself. Paramount always remained loyal to the legacy of Jason Voorhees. The films were actual sequels with each film set where the previous one left off. They also used several characters other than Jason more than once, such as Alice or Tommy Jarvis. I like to think of each Friday the 13th film made during the Paramount era as a chapter in the Jason Voorhees legacy. Much like a book, each chapter follows where the previous one ended. Seldom ever do you read the first 8 chapters of a book and have the 9th one totally disregard the events of the previous 7 or 8. Why? Because it doesn't work for a continuing story. Although it doesn't make clear logical sense to create such a film, Cunningham and New Line didn't flinch the least bit at the idea and moved forward to create films that had little to no relevance to the films that fans grew to love. With the failure of Jason Takes Manhattan and a growing shame of harvesting such a franchise, Paramount decided they no longer wanted anything to do with the masked slasher. Like an old overused car, Jason Voorhees was now up for sale.
Paramount pretty much was always embarrassed by the success of the Friday the 13th films. This is something they didn't want to be known for. You know, this is a studio that made movies like Ordinary People.
Paramount Pictures was ashamed of Friday the 13th. They weren't proud of it at all.
Cunningham took back control of the legacy and in 1992, sells the rights to New Line in a desperate attempt to save his film career. To many fans, it was hope for new sequels to come, but to others, it was a betrayal. Jason was now chained in the house that Freddy built. Not taking the franchise seriously, New Line leaves complete control of the new film to Sean Cunningham, who then makes the mistake of placing it in the hands of his son's best friend, Adam Marcus, who then brings along his best friend, Dean Laurie. Prior to Jason Goes to Hell, the only experience Marcus had in film was having went to film school and being a PA on several films.
And for the previous movie you did for Sean, weren't you a PA?
I was.
So
I
you're
was.
Like, you went from
PA
from being a production
to
assistant to
yes.
directing a movie.
Yep.
This would ultimately result in one of the worst films in the franchise. Along with the useless guidance of Sean Cunningham, Adam Marcus arrogantly and selfishly decides to ignore all of the legendary films that preceded it. He states, "One of the first decisions made was to completely ignore Jason Takes Manhattan. No one liked that film. It had a great idea, but it was all on a boat. I kind of liked The New Blood because it tried to be something with the Jason versus Carrie angle, but we wanted to forget everything that happened previously except for the original film and parts of Part 2. I didn't want the final Friday to be tied to anything besides what happened in the first film.
Well, what better time than Friday the 13th to open the last of the Friday the 13th movies? The title of this one is Jason Goes to Hell, The Final Friday.
With its only relevance to the rest of the series being the Jason Voorhees character and the setting. That's it. Marcus claimed to have wanted to do something different since, in his opinion, all the previous films used the same basic formula. But when we take a look at the last time the franchise tried to do something different, as with Jason Takes Manhattan, it failed. In numerous interviews and the DVD commentary for The Final Friday, Marcus claims that
it's a film for the fans, by the fans. He pulled the evil spirit of Jason out of Jason's body for the length of the picture. He's only on screen for two sequences.
A Friday the 13th film? Fans? Well, not only is this not a pure Friday the 13th film, the film doesn't even have the Friday name for crying out loud. It has the third worst rating of the Friday the 13th films on IMDb. Throughout the commentary on the DVD, neither Marcus nor Laurie convinced the listener that ever did they take the production of the film seriously. They even spelled the Voorhees name wrong once in the film. If they were the fans they claimed to be, that would not have slipped through the cracks. But however, I don't entirely disagree with everything Marcus brings up in the commentary. At one point he says,
"We were very lucky, because we had no right to be helming a movie at this point in our lives."
Personally, Adam, I couldn't agree more. The Final Friday posed many problems for many, but of course not all, dedicated fans. The only way the film could make any sense is if you do, in fact, ignore the previous films as Marcus intended. But here lies the problem. Most fans cherish the films that preceded it, thus, they'd rather not ignore them. Why would they want to ignore them? The previous films are what attracted us to the series in the first place. We grew up loving these films, and now you're just going to pretend they never happened? Here are the major flaws found in The Final Friday, posed from fan perspective, if taking the previous films into consideration, which of course you should. First, Jason just pops in. There isn't any exposition or explanation concerning how he returned to Crystal Lake from Manhattan. In fact, the film isn't even a true sequel that follows the rest of the series. According to Dictionary.com, a sequel is defined as a literary work, movie, etc., that is complete in itself but continues the narrative of a preceding work. And since The Final Friday does not continue the narrative from Jason Takes Manhattan, or at the very least reference it, it is not a sequel and offers nothing to the original franchise. As far as I'm concerned, the franchise died with the conclusion of Jason Takes Manhattan.
Keep it all intact. Make it all count. Don't discount all the other movies, and the fans will love you for it.
Jason's appearance. His head has the look of a cheap, oversized latex Halloween mask. Jason had also grown some long gray hair and gained some weight. And because of poor cinematography, forced perspective had not been used to make Hodder appear as large as we would expect Jason to be. For example, this scene where he flips over the jungle gym. Our monstrous hero loses balance. But don't worry so much about his physical appearance because, third, in original physical form, he's hardly in the movie. The icon every fan grew to love only appears on screen for maybe 15 minutes. Fans paid to see Jason, not a bunch of ordinary people in need of an exorcist.
Only on screen for two sequences, which made a lot of fans unhappy. And then there were a lot of fans who got it and loved it. It was like, it's different. Finally, it's a little different. I didn't want it to be every other Jason movie. I wanted it to be different. I wanted people to miss Jason. And then when they get him back, it's like a prize.
A prize? If seeing Jason in his original physical form for only a few minutes is a prize, then so is winning a single dollar from a $5 scratch-off. What is the point if the prize isn't worth the time and money spent to receive it? Fourth, Jason talks. Never before did Jason ever speak a word, with the exception of a few flashbacks throughout the series. In this film, once Jason's soul takes over the body of a police officer, he seems to be well-spoken.
Get the hell away from her, Ed!
Not bad for someone who hasn't spoken a word in over 30 years.
Now, here's the only problem with this sequence. Up until now, Jason has never spoken a word because Jason doesn't speak.
Right.
And of course, we broke our own rule by having both actors speak in this scene, so yeah. You don't know which one of them.
I remember we debated this a long time
because we
didn't know how to do it otherwise.
Not sure how to do it? Well, guess what? You don't have to do it at all. 5. Body hopping. This pretty much speaks for itself. Jason is reanimated dead flesh, not a demon rat.
Body switching, and Jason goes to hell, I think that was a terrible, terrible decision. The fact that Jason turned into a slug in part 9, unacceptable.
6. The mystical aspect. One of the most frightening aspects of the previous films is being oblivious to the force that drives Jason to kill well beyond death. Is it vengeance? Is it evil? By delving into this whole complicated myth of how to stop Jason with a magical dagger destroys the element of mystery that Friday the 13th legacy maintained for 8 films. Who the hell is Creighton Duke? He doesn't have any backstory, nor do we ever find out how he came across the knowledge of how to destroy Jason. Although a backstory was originally written for Duke, it was not included in the film, thus making him another faceless character with silly one-liners.
That's my lady you're talking about.
Well, now see, she is only your lady because she ain't had a taste of the Duke yet.
This role should have been given to Tommy Jarvis, the one character with the most experience with Jason.
Jason belongs in hell. I'm gonna see he gets there.
Jason, come on! Come and get me! It's me you want, remember?
Perhaps for the above reasons, the film failed both at the box office and with the fan base. To many fans, the franchise was murdered, but not because Jason was cast into hell by a magical dagger, but rather because the films didn't fit anywhere into the series. Like a little child playing with a broken radio, Marcus and Laurie put parts together that just didn't make any logical sense. But let's not place the blame entirely on them, but rather the guy who hired them in the first place, Sean Cunningham. Without a doubt, both Friday the 13th and slasher genre fans should, to some extent, show some respect towards Cunningham since, after all, he did play a major role in kickstarting the franchise, and the slasher genre for that matter. But what are the fans to think when the founder of their favorite series begins to harm that very same series? Cunningham admits to have never seen any of the Paramount sequels that followed Part 2. He states, "People must think I've seen all of the other sequels, but I really never did. I was interested when I heard that New Line Cinema was involved because I thought they're a great company and I wanted to have a relationship with them, not just in terms of the Friday the 13th franchise, but others as well." In other words, Cunningham had no interest in the series until he found an opportunity to capitalize off it through the mechanics of New Line Cinema. Thus, it becomes quite apparent why Cunningham's supervision of the final Friday was minimal and worthless. He knew so little of the series that he even suggested this to Marcus.
Well, the plot was actually dictated by Sean. Not that he came up with the plot, but basically what he said was, "I want that damn hockey mask out of the movie. So whatever you come up with that gets the damn hockey mask out, let's make that movie."
Now, how can you make a sequel to a series of films that, for the most part, you have never seen? The answer becomes obvious. You ignore them. Does it make sense? Well, this is the crime perpetrated by Cunningham. This wouldn't be the first moment in the history of the franchise where fans would watch this happen.
Our first movie is Jason X. It's kind of an extreme sports entry in the grisly series of Friday the 13th splatter films about that machete-wielding goon in a hockey mask. Jason himself has been wiped out more times than Kenny on South Park, but he always springs back to life, as does the franchise.
Several years would pass without a new Jason film, while Freddy vs. Jason lingered in limbo. One thing led to another, and eventually, Jason X was born. According to Cunningham, the project was greenlit to keep Jason fresh in the minds of the movie-going audience until Freddy vs. Jason hit screens. He states, "I didn't really want to do another Friday the 13th film, but I was growing impatient with the progress of Freddy vs. Jason, and I felt I had to keep Jason active. I wasn't going to do it, regardless, if there wasn't a fresh concept because I really felt like there wasn't anything interesting to do with Jason anymore." In other words, Jason was merely a marketing tool, nothing more. Now the flaws with this film are quite obvious. At least the Final Friday was set in Jason's original hunting grounds, but now space? Not only should they have learned for a second time that doing something different with the series doesn't work, but they also didn't take into consideration that throwing an iconic character into space doesn't work either. We've seen the unpleasant results of placing the leprechaun and Pinhead into space, but now Jason?
So we had a long list of like 8 different scenarios to drop Jason in. Jason in the snow, Jason in the North Pole, in Africa, you know, we just let it go.
eventually, I said, well, how about Jason in space?
It's hilarious to believe that these were even serious ideas. In Jason X, although the Paramount spirit of Jason had been resurrected to hack up teens in good 80s fashion, the feel and setting of the film distracted fans from the long-gone Jason mentality that had returned to the series. Jason had a new look, new arsenal, new turf, and new century. It was fast-paced, brutal, and aggressive like the original films without all the mystical aspects that bogged down the pace as with the previous film. Although the film did work logically to some extent, the fans didn't want it. To most, a futuristic Jason in space is like having anchovies on your ice cream. Could you have ice cream with anchovies? Sure you could, but would you want it? Probably not. Anchovies don't belong on ice cream, and Jason didn't belong in space. Fans grew to love that dirty, gritty, decayed Jason of the previous films. Placing him in space and turning him into a cyborg would soon make Jason X a major embarrassment of the series. Although, in my opinion, the least unpleasant film of the New Line Fridays.
It's Jason hacking and slashing and picking people up and smashing them to bits. And if you want to see that, it's good, I guess, or it's not worse than the other Friday the 13th
movie. I am tired of it.
Whatever happened to Jason versus Freddy? What are these people doing? They said we were going to have Jason versus Freddy.
They have to battle because I want to kick Freddy's ass.
Freddy's the smartest villain in history, and Jason's a mongoloid. How fair could the fight be?
There isn't any great navigational plan in mind. There is just a really, truly, and honestly overweening desire to make this film, which I think a lot of fans are waiting for, as good as we could possibly think of making it.
In 2002, production finally began on the Freddy vs. Jason project. Soon after, a website was created to promote the film, allowing fans to get their first glimpse of the movie from several promotional photos and a short minute-long trailer. The horror world was now in an uproar. From the look of the trailer, I had high hopes. It made a small reference to the first of each film in each series, which to me demonstrated that they didn't forget Jason's past. And also, it presented Jason as the dark, mysterious character he truly is. Over 20 years of bloodshed would finally lead to this single film. Two major horror franchises were now crossing paths, causing the slasher genre to finally come full circle. While many fans were excited to see the two legends in the same film, others were skeptical of whether New Line could pull it off while remaining faithful to the Friday fans, since, after all, they had already damaged the series by releasing Jason Goes to Hell and Jason X. But once it was released to the public that Kane Hodder was being replaced by a Canadian stuntman in the new film, suspicions of disloyalty to the Friday fan base were now once again made a reality. When New Line decided not to have Hodder reprise his role, they at the same time decided not to use the well-established Jason character we grew to love. When I finally saw the film, it was at a rundown theater jammed with young kids. As I watched the film amongst a loud, energetic crowd, I took each frame into consideration, while, at the same time, hoping that New Line didn't screw up what could be the most significant slasher film in the genre's history. I was glad it did the Jason legend justice, but there was certainly something with the film that just didn't sit right. The Jason character itself was vastly different from what we were used to. After watching the film several more times, those elements that made the film awkward became more apparent. 1. Jason's appearance. The mask barely had any damage to it, with the exception of the signature axe cut found in only a single shot of the movie. It also seemed much too large for his face, including the large vent and eye holes, exposing his eyes throughout most of the film. The eyes here give the impression that he is a depressed and misunderstood character, which is certainly not a characteristic of Jason. 2. The distance between Crystal Lake and Springwood. Not only does Jason walk from one state to another wearing a hockey mask and holding a machete, but he does so in a single night, without GPS. 3. Tranquilizers. I couldn't believe it. Nor bullets, knives, axes, or cars can stop Jason. But tranquilizers? Jason is dead, thus drugging him would have no effect on him. Having characters tranquilize Jason as if he were some sort of wild animal demonstrates the disrespect the writers had for the character. 4. Horrible casting, acting, and dialogue. The acting in both franchises always seemed mediocre and acceptable, but with this film, it seemed as if they were told to act horribly.
He had this dark brown hat, and his skin was terribly burned, and then on his right hand, he had like these razor fingers.
They were so bad that it distracted me from the events unfolding on the screen. Our lead in the film is ironically the worst of them all, making it difficult for me to take her, or anyone else for that matter, seriously. In addition, according to casting director Matthew Barry, the studio wanted some kind of hip-hop quotient for the movie. We interviewed Eve and Pink and all these other hip-hop artists, and most of them just couldn't act their way out of a paper bag. And Kelly Rowland can?
Tell me something. What kind of faggot runs around in a Christmas sweater? I mean, come on, get real. You're not even scary. You're not even scary.
It's rather pathetic to think that the studio feels they must throw in a hip-hop star to please another demographic, when, in most cases, it results in something like this.
Michael, come and see me! Look at me!
Wanna fuck with me? Huh? Fucker.
Trick or treat, motherfucker!
Cartoonish kills. The kills seemed extremely unrealistic and overly exaggerated. For example, simple slash wounds resulting in blood shooting several feet into the air. We didn't see any anger, rage, or aggression with the kills. Robert Englund describes the final fight scene as Roadrunner-like. The screenwriters themselves, Damian Shannon and Mark Swift, suggest that their script was turned into a cartoon.
Also, what we did was, as kind of a reaction to Freddy vs. Jason, we wanted to adjust the tone.
Yeah.
We wanted to make this less goofy,
Yeah. More
serious, a little harder edged.
Yeah, FVJ got a little campier than we wanted, a little goofier than we wanted, a little too cartoony.
6. The absence of Kane Hodder.
The first two movies that I did, Part 7 and Part 8, I was amazed that I was actually playing this character. And once I got everything on and put the hockey mask on, it felt so natural. I just felt like that was the part that I was born to play.
Kane Hodder as Jason has a certain vocabulary of movement that he's created. He actually has a thing where his head moves first and then the body follows.
He's the kind of guy who will stand while blocking a scene, will look the director and the writer dead in the face and say, "No, Jason won't do that." And cause the writer and the director to go, "Okay."
The most controversial issue with the film is the fact that Kane Hodder was not invited to reprise his role. This would truly damage the film for many Friday fans, since it was his interpretation of the character, mannerisms and all, that have defined the Jason we're so familiar with. This demonstrates New Line's carelessness for the character. For what possible reason could New Line decide not to use the iconic stuntman who's portrayed the character for 4 straight films? Here is where things get a bit complicated. According to Ronnie Yu, it was New Line that decided not to use Hodder.
We've been looking for the new Jason, and because the studio, the moment I signed on the studio, they asked me if I mind. They just want to have a new actor to play Jason, you know. I said it's fine, you know. I didn't really ask why and all that, because it's a studio. I'm just a director.
He goes on to state in an interview, "I had no problem with Kane. Kane did fantastic work. But the studio thought it was a good idea to change. Ultimately, it was not my call. It was really New Line's." Okay, so was it the execs that decided against Hodder? Let's hear what executive producer Doug Curtis has to say. Ronnie Yu didn't really care. To Ronnie, it was a non-issue. But Stokely, to her credit, did not want the guy. She thought Kane wasn't scary and that he was too chunky. You might be wondering, who the hell is Stokely and why does she dislike Hodder so much? Well, Stokely Chafin is another producer from New Line. She had been involved with more modern pop horror like I Know What You Did Last Summer, Soul Survivors, and eventually, Snakes on a Plane. With credits like these, she's hardly qualified to state what is scary and what is not. Let's hear what the casting director, Matthew Barry, has to say about Hodder. "Kane came to me and basically said, 'This means a lot to me. I have a lot of fans. Don't take this away from me.' But in the end, you always have to do what's best for the film. And Ronnie thought recasting Jason would be the right thing to do. And to be honest, so did I. Kane was physically too big. He didn't fit the image that Ronnie was looking for. Ronnie wanted to focus on Jason's eyes, and he felt Kane was a little too cartoony in the last few films. It was about movement too, at least compared to the other films, where Jason just kind of walks around like Frankenstein. There's a lot more to him in this one. Wait a second. Didn't Ronnie Yu state earlier it was New Line's choice to drop Hodder and not his?
On Freddy vs. Jason, they went a different direction with casting Jason and didn't cast Kane Hodder, and I was really surprised.
Also, I find it ironic that Barry states the new Jason was more about movement and not Frankenstein mentality, when in fact, Yu directs Ken Kurtzinger, the stuntman ultimately hired to take the role, to think of the role as Frankenstein.
I just went back to my childhood. I think I thought a lot about Frankenstein. Not really alive, but not really dead. Even if you look at the movements, the walk and stuff like that, I think I used a little bit of Frankenstein.
So if Hodder wasn't qualified to don the hockey mask, what qualified Ken? According to Jeff Katz, Kane has his fans, obviously. But with a new guy, we could bring something new to the table. And ultimately, Ken's Jason is more to the point and more brutal. More to the point? Brutal? As Jason, Kane has killed 50 plus victims, with items anywhere from axes to party horns. Yet Kat states Ken's portrayal is more brutal? Has he even ever seen the other films? But what is more disturbing is the fact that these execs and the casting director were all well aware of Kane's fan base, which includes much of the horror community. And yes, they still wanted to drop him, with the exception of Cunningham. Yes, Cunningham had made some poor choices with the New Line Fridays prior to this one. But at the very least, he always accepted Hodder as the definitive Jason. He states, it was New Line's decision to hire a new actor for the role. A lot of people, including me, thought they should have stayed with Kane Hodder, but the studio wanted to try something different to make it fresh. To me, it was done for no good reason, but at some point, the people that write the checks get a cut, if you know what I mean. Of all the people who had anything to do with Freddy vs. Jason, Kane was the one that I think was not treated as well as he should have been.
I really wanted to use Kane, and then Ronnie Yu decided that he really kind of liked this other guy, and he was directing the movie, and I said, fine. It was a shame at some level that Kane didn't get to do it.
But of all the words spoken on the controversy, the ones that speak the loudest come from Ken Kurtzinger himself. While talking to William Terzakis, the makeup effects supervisor on Freddy vs. Jason, Terzakis states in an interview, and when he first came to the shop, honestly, he didn't know a heck of a lot about the character. He was nervous. He asked me, what's this guy supposed to be like? What do we do? On top of this, Ken states to Ronnie Yu, I am not going to live up to Kane. These words speak for themselves. What brought about these major problematic flaws? Why was the look of the film so drastically different and at times awkward in relation to the Nightmare and Friday franchises? The answer to this question would be the largest mistake New Line Cinema would make with the production of Freddy vs. Jason, Ronnie Yu. Executive producer Stokely Chafin was put in charge of finding a director.
And then there were people who had more experience but kind of were like, oh yeah, I think I saw one back in the theater way back when. And we were like, what are you doing here? Like, why would you want to take this on if you don't care about these characters?
Wait a second, what does she say?
What are you doing here? Like, why would you want to take this on if you don't care about these characters?
Well, that's funny, since Ronnie Yu states in an interview, Bob asked me if I had seen any of the Friday the 13th films or Nightmare on Elm Street sequels. I said no. He said, you mean no Jason? No Freddy? It's funny because the same thing happened with Bride of Chucky. I had never seen a Child's Play film. And once again, in an About.com interview, I watched the first one, Nightmare on Elm Street, in Hong Kong, and I watched the first Friday the 13th. I said, that's all I know about the franchises. New Line says, fine, we don't need you to be a professor on this franchise to do it. Once again, New Line portrays themselves as the caregivers of the horror genre when in fact, the truth shines a different light. According to Robert Shea, CEO of New Line Cinema, the choice to have Ronnie Yu on board as director was based upon his previous horror comedy film, Bride of Chucky, and that he was Asian.
And then Stokely brought me I saw the two films that she suggested I see that would give me some feeling about the guy, which was The Bride with White Hair and the Chucky, Bride of Chucky, I guess. I was into brides. And I thought that they were quite well done. And the idea of having a Asian point of view and Asian style.
Bride of Chucky was a ridiculous film that made a mockery of the Child's Play series. Frank Mancuso Jr., who produced most of the Friday films during the Paramount era, had one major rule for his directors to abide when making a Friday the 13th film.
So my discussions with Frank Mancuso Jr. were really in, you know, how do we make sure this delivers for the audience? I do want to have, you know, a sense of style and humor with it. And he said, you know, fine, just don't make fun of Jason.
New Line obviously didn't hold the same respect for the character and decided to hire a director that had already made a major contribution to the mockery of another horror series. But more importantly, let's take a closer look at the second reason why he was hired. Because Robert Shea thought it'd be interesting to have an Asian perspective, or to put it more bluntly, because he's Asian. Ronnie Yu directing from an Asian perspective should not be a reason to hire him, but rather a reason not to hire him. The Friday the 13th story is inspired by myths that originated from the old campfire tales that were once passed from one camper to another up and down the east coast of the United States.
These campfire tales started on the east coast. Spooky tales that counselors used to tell at night to keep kids in line. Pretty much there were variations of that that kind of got handed down and eventually saw fruition in the Friday the 13th films and all the slasher films that came out after that.
Now, a director born and raised in a different part of the world will not fully understand the tradition in the same sense as those who grew up with it. Therefore, it would only make sense to hire a director with an understanding of the American audience, or in other words, someone who recognizes their cultural perspective. When we take an in-depth look at Yu's filmography, we notice that he's made three American films prior to Freddy vs. Jason, and before that, about 15 or so unsuccessful Hong Kong flicks. For such a significant film, you'd think they hire someone with more experience, but not only experience in filmmaking, but the genre as well. Ronnie Yu never saw Friday the 13th or A Nightmare on Elm Street, as he admits in an interview. This explains a lot. If Freddy vs. Jason was a film that stood on its own without a prior history, I wouldn't be so concerned about its cultural relevance in regards to who was directing it. I tend to not care about characters or tales I'm not familiar with, but because this is a sequel to two very well-established franchises that spanned over two decades, I do worry. I, as well as millions, grew up watching these films, and we've watched them become a part of our American culture, whether for good or worse. I'm by no means saying there is anything wrong with the Asian style of filmmaking, but rather it isn't compatible with American slasher films. So that was a lot of information I just threw at you. Allow me to go over the crucial facts that led to the travesty of Freddy vs. Jason. 1. New Line turns Jason into Frankenstein's monster. Casting director Matthew Barry mentions he didn't want someone who moved like Frankenstein, when in fact, that's exactly how Ronnie Yu directs Ken Kurtzinger to move. Never in any of the previous Friday the 13th films does Jason move like Frankenstein. 2. New Line kicked Kane Hodder aside.
I want to kick Freddy's ass. That was the part that I was born to play.
Ronnie Yu blames the executives for not going with Hodder. Several of the executives blame Ronnie Yu. With all this finger pointing, I think it's obvious that New Line realized they made a huge mistake. New Line begs Ronnie Yu to direct. I have absolutely no idea why this guy was hired. Bob Shea must have been lying when he said they chose him because they enjoyed Bride of Chucky. I can't imagine that film qualifying anyone to direct a film on the scale of Freddy vs. Jason. In addition, the executives claim that they wanted someone passionate about the characters.
There was a problem in finding somebody who was good and had the enthusiasm for it in the same way that we had trouble finding a production executive.
When in fact, you kept passing on the offer.
Ronnie Yu was on that list. We went to him and he passed. I was like, okay, I expected that.
Then she approached Ronnie, or his agent again. Is it possible that he might want to revisit this whole thing?
So we got him on the phone, and I kind of thought it was a lost cause because I just expected him to say, thanks so much, you know, for your interest. I really appreciate it, but no.
If he kept passing on it, he clearly wasn't enthusiastic. Oh yeah, let's not forget he had never seen any of the sequels. That means he had only seen 2 movies out of 17. February, Friday the 13th, 2009, marks the actual date of death of the Friday the 13th series with the wretched Platinum Dunes remake. A truly unlucky day for one of the most prolific horror franchises in cinematic history. Paramount Pictures returns to team up with New Line to cash in on the very franchise they had been ashamed of several decades earlier. I'd like to ask a few hypothetical questions. Firstly, where will Jason be in the next 20 years? Will he be battling space aliens in a sequel to Jason X? Will he duke it out with Michael Myers in Alaska? Or perhaps the Leprechaun in Africa? Would it really matter at this point? Of course these are just movies, but for many of us, these movies are an escape from the everyday mundane realities of life. For others, they're nostalgic and reunite us with a past we grew to love. And like many things we grow to love, we hate to see them manipulated and contorted in an attempt to entertain a new generation, or in other words, cash in at the box office. This, along with ignorance and disloyalty, is what killed the Friday the 13th series, and New Line sat back and allowed it to unfold. Like with the Halloween franchise, the newer generation will forever judge the Paramount era of Friday films by Freddy vs. Jason or the remake, both of which redefined Jason Voorhees. Most Friday the 13th fans will agree that Jason should remain on the grounds of Camp Crystal Lake, and according to the Crystal Lake legend, that's where it belongs.